today because Iowa has a new face. I don't know if you're aware of this, but we don't, all of us are sort of naive about Africa being the world's second largest continent and having 49 countries in it. I have to admit I know very little about it. And I was surprised that even in my own hometown of Sioux City, there's over 1,000 East African immigrants living in that community. And in places like Des Moines, there's 8,000. Also, large groups are living in Waterloo, Cedar Rapids, Storm Lake, and Marshalltown. Come from many different countries, they share many different dialects. So this is a challenge for Iowans to welcome these people into our community and learn a little bit about their culture. And that's exactly why we've asked Dr. Kusau to come here today, so he can enlighten us about some of the experiences that people coming from Somalia, Rwanda, Nigeria, many, many countries, which we really know very little about, or at least I do. Professor Kusau is currently Associate Professor of Sociology and African and African American Studies at Iowa State University. We really appreciate him taking the time to drive over here today. His research interests include globalization and transnational migration, the contemporary African diaspora, social transformation and social change in Africa, African immigrants in North America. I think he'll help us understand why are people coming here in such great numbers. He's published in many scholarly journals, has participated in several international policy forums on Africa sponsored by the United Nations Scientific, Educational, and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, you might be more familiar with it that way, and the United Nations Development Program. So he comes to here with a real international understanding of this issue, and we're very glad that he came here today. So let's welcome him, and feel free to ask questions after his talk is over. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mary. I really appreciate, and I was looking forward to coming here. As Mary said, I think this is really not just even about African immigrants or Africans or the black population in the United States, but it is part of a changing phase of America. Itself, in that over the last 20 years or 30 years, the number of immigrants from Africa, from South America, from Asia has increased such that the overall racial and ethnic demography of the American society is changing towards a higher level of diversity, right? So that's very, very important in understanding. I want to also point out that this is not just a recent phenomenon. This is just not something unique to today. America has been changing from a racial demographic point of view the last 200, 300 years. We all know how America started from a sort of a racial and religious point of view, and over the last 300 years has changed fundamentally. If you take the example of, for example, the Catholic American population of the United States today, if you look back, you will see that nearly 70% or so came only after the 1880s. So the nation has been changing, adding a different religion, a different ethnic background, and so forth and so forth. So that's what this lecture is about, and it's specifically about the fact that the black population itself, like the nation, has been going through a similar transformation. Historically, our understanding of the black population in the United States was primarily based on the idea of skin color. I remember not just the black population, but our general understanding of ethnic identities was simply overwhelmed by the idea of white, black, right, and nothing beyond that. So our understanding of African Americans was primarily derived from skin color in this sense. Even though we know that the black population came from different regions of the continent, came from different languages and different societies and so forth, right? So because of that, the last 30 years or 20 years also, an increasing number of black immigrants from the Caribbean and from Africa have joined the United States. Today, nearly 12% of the black population is of foreign background. And so that is very, very significant. You could see that in the Midwest, you could see that in New York City, you could see that in Philadelphia, and so forth. So what that did is that it infused a different kind of black Americanness, a different kind of African Americanness. Yeah? So when we think about a typical African-American male or female, we think about skin color, but everything beyond that, whether it's religion, whether it's style, whether it's dress, whether it's the way, the manners, and everything is as American as anyone else, right? So we have that typical idea. When we see something like this, we would not think about America. They suddenly now give us as an impression that, wait a minute, if I ask you now, you will say, well, this is a family somewhere in Africa, all right? But this is an extended African-American family of West African descent that is actually picnicking in a park in Philadelphia, right? What about that, right? So now, we have a totally different look, a different identity. And this is Somali refugees in Minneapolis. When we see that, remember, when we see something like this, we don't even think about skin color, certainly. Now, maybe something else overwhelms the idea of skin color, right? The way they dress, right? So now you may think about Islam in a state of skin color. So it's fascinating in that sense. So to just show that today, just like the American society, the black population itself is going through a fundamental transformation in this sense, right? So because of that, two things are occurring. The native or the historic African-American population itself, like every other American, is adjusting with this identity, right? Because they themselves are new to this idea, number one, in terms of identity. And number two, there has been an increasing discussion that in general, an increasing discussion that has started at the turn of the 20th century, in the first decades of the 1900s, that in general, black immigrants at that point from the Caribbean, from Jamaica primarily, were more educated and more economically successful than the historical Native African American population. That was one argument. That argument started in the early 1900s, and it continues up to today. An African American sociologist by the name of Ira Reed wrote an interesting book in about 1935, where he looked at compared African-Americans and immigrants from the Caribbean, English-speaking Caribbean immigrants from New York, and found that the majority of the black immigrant population from the Caribbean were more educated, had higher levels of professional engagement, and so forth, and even including the second generation, right? So that discussion continued all the way to today. What I'm showing you now is another report just in 2000, where another American sociologist, John Logan, tried to compare socioeconomic achievement levels between African Americans and black immigrants from the Caribbean and from Africa with a number of American ethnic groups, right? So what you see there is that a situation in that, for example, the average for the African immigrant population, right, is not only more educated than, on the average, right, not only more educated than African Americans, but has the highest level of number of years of schooling in the entire nation. All right. I compare it to the general population, and compare it to Asian American population. Right. So what you see is really a group of immigrants who are, on the average, doing very well. The point is that this information comes from the 2000 census. It's not something that collected through survey or whatever. It's based on the U.S. Census data. But when you compare African Americans, the Native African American population, and the black immigrant population, you will see differences in median family income as well. Right. So you will see that. So this then, John Logan suggested that really overall, the black immigrant population, and particularly that segment that comes from Africa, is very highly educated in that sense, right? So this discussion is started in the early 1900s, and it continues to the day. More so, the discussion continued at the level of the participation in the American Ivy League colleges. This is another report. Now, Douglas Massey, another American sociologist at Princeton University, looked at, for example, a longitudinal survey that's done every year on American colleges and universities that tracks down the achievement levels of incoming freshmen all the way to when they finish and what they end up doing in the future. And what they did is that they selected the black young men and women who were in all of these different universities and colleges in the United States, and they tried to compare the native population with the immigrant population. And as you can see, in the all public universities, you see 70% of the young men and women who are in these colleges are of native origin, while 20% or 23% are of immigrant origin. But Douglas Massey really focuses on the elite institutions. So if you look at the Ivy League colleges, right, the Ivy League colleges, the 10 or so, Harvard, Yale, Brown, Princeton, what they found was that 59% were of native background, where 40% were of foreign background, right? First and second generation. Right? So the argument is that even though the black population in these Ivy League the black population of the United States, the black immigrant population of the United States only represented 10% of the total black population, they represented 40% of those who were entering the Ivy League colleges. Remember, this has multiple implications and even sort of tension between the two communities in this sense, and this is something that slowly is starting to appear. But the fascinating thing really is this. Again, let's look at this, right? This is, again, comes from Douglas Massey's research. And when they desegregated that 40%, where do these different immigrant groups come from in the Ivy League colleges? They found that 28% came from Africa, 43% came from the Caribbean, 7.4% came from Latin America, and 20% other meaning, even Europe, you know, black immigrants from Africa who settled in Europe and then later came here. So it's a multiple situation. What's even more fascinating is that is here, that when they again desegregated these numbers, they found that you know, when you let me go back one page and see 43%. Let's take the 28% Africa, and now look at this. Right, out of the 20%, right? Remember, we said 20% of those who are in the Ivy League colleges were from Africa, right? Of that 20%, 17.3% came from Nigeria. 6.4% came from Ghana. Taken together, one can make the argument that this entire Africa name or comment may be just immigrants that are coming from two or three countries. You see that it's really very fascinating, because when you only look at the data from the general census and you see, for example, 40% of those in the Ivy Leagues are of African background, that is not actually the case, right? That's not the case in this sense. The same thing with the case of the Caribbean immigrants, that 20% of the 43% came from Jamaica, 9% from Haiti, 7% from Trinidad. So now what you're seeing is that wait a minute. Really, the success, the socioeconomic success, the success that we're talking about is maybe specific to certain regions, countries, and areas, but not necessarily Africa itself. Well, of course, it's still the argument holds on the aggregate, because we're talking about a mean, and the mean cannot be as high unless there is enough number of people who are relatively well educated. All right. So this discussion created a national controversy. Even if you actually Google, you'll find that. For example, in 2008, just after the report was published, Louise Gates Jr., who is actually was the chair of the African American Studies at Harvard, supposedly one of the leading scholars, and Lani Gunier. Lani Gunier is a lawyer who was actually the whom President Clinton appointed as attorney, well, at least nominated as attorney general, but there were some controversies later on. What I'm suggesting is that we're talking about two extremely influential individuals who participated in the what's called the Black Harvard Alumni annual meeting type thing, and the comment that they both made to the news media was that they were really surprised that almost everybody in the Harvard class of that year who came to that alumni party were of foreign background. And so the underlying argument was simply that America is, well, it has implications for affirmative action, let's say, other compensatory issues. And the argument is that we're not necessarily supporting the groups and the people for whom the entire idea was articulated initially, right? You know, so that's that argument. I'm only trying to point out with this data that these kinds of presentations and information organizing creates a situation in which a certain level of intensity and antagonism starts to form within the black population in this sense. So I was concerned about that, and I wanted to look at deeper and say, well, wait a minute, there must be something interesting. Actually, one of the legal articles on this issue was written by one of your neighbors here, Uwanjo Ilik, who is at the University of Iowa, Iowa's law school, I think. Two reports were written on this, and one is written by her, I think, in 2007. And I can share with you that if you like. So I became curious about that. And this is just to really show you this massive demographic transformation. And what you see is that the black immigrant population is nearing 1 million now, 800,000 or so, and the majority of which came just after 1990s and the 2000. So just show you the percentage change in some situations is massive, as you can see. Right? But I wanted to really move faster so that we have time for questions. So this is my own data then that comes from the 1980, 1990, and 2000 census, because I wanted to follow all through. But what I did is that I disaggregated the data. Now I'm looking at country of origin instead of just this massive data, right? So then what you would see is, for example, if you look, and we're not just talking about college graduate, but we're not talking about just high school, but we're talking about college graduates, 1980, 1990, and 2000. What you will see is that in some situations, the percent of college graduates among certain country of origin is extremely high. Right? By the way, the percent of college graduates among the general population is, you think, what, 24 to 26%, right? So I want you to put that in context. Now you're seeing 55% of that population being college graduates. So you have, for example, you have Nigeria, 62%, right? You have South Africa, 51%. But what I want you to look at is that there are, take at Somalia, for example. In 1980, 23%, right? In 1990, 35%. In 2000, 15%, right? It's going down, right? In the case of Ethiopia, 42%, 33%, and 30%. It's going down as well. So what's happening is that the two countries from South Africa, that is South Africa and Zimbabwe, have a high level of college graduation. Two, three countries from the West, particularly Ghana and Nigeria, have high levels of college graduation. Three countries from the East, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania, have higher levels of socioeconomic, college graduation. And if you look at median income, right, if you look at median income and look at the Republic of South Africa, in 2000, 72,000. Median family income, right? The average for the general population may be 45 or something, nearing maybe 50. That 72,000 is the highest among any group in the United States, right? But again, then we look at, for example, poverty level, right? When we look at poverty level, what you will see is that you have sometimes poverty levels that are in 2000, 23% in the case of Somalia. So what you see, again, is that you have poverty levels that are extremely high and poverty levels that are much, much below the national level. So this is the data. So what you see is that when you see something like this, it's really very difficult to speak about an African immigrant population that can be understood as doing very well and participating in the Ivy League colleges and so forth and so forth. So the argument is that, wait a minute, it's not really, when we talk about these issues, we should not lump together all of these different groups, right? And by the way, an interesting example is the Asian American population. General understanding that they are overwhelmingly successful, but that glosses over a number of groups within the Asian American population that are not actually doing very well in this sense. So I'm trying to suggest that wait a minute, we have to be careful. Right? We have to be careful because we have a number of immigrants from Africa who are not doing well. Especially, by the way, the one is in the Midwest, the one is in Iowa, are the ones that are not doing very well. Because these are the refugees, right? These are the Somalis, these are the Sudanese, these are the Rwandans, these are the Burundians, right? So it is exactly that reason why we're trying to expand the picture and say, wait a minute, this is what's going on. But even beyond that, we want to know who the Africans are. Well, first let me look at this. We want to understand that this is probably one of the, if not the most diverse continent in the entire world, whether we understand it that way or not, right? This may be the most diverse continent in the world, whether it is from an ethnic and racial point of view, whether it is from a cultural point of view, right? Where, imagine if people in Iowa, the 4 million or so people in Iowa, speak 20 different languages, right? So when you look at this map, you have North Africa, where the majority of the population are of a Middle Eastern background, Arabic speaking, and when they come to the United States, they are classified as white, right? And Muslim at the same time. You look at West Africa, it is Christianity, the majority of the people are Christian, and so this is part of, this is where the majority of the West African coast is where the majority of the native or the historical African American population came from. But there we have Nigeria, a country that has about 170 million people, right? On all accounts, a relatively wealthy country with an appreciable level of human skills. We have Ghana, but we have Sierra Leone, we have Senegal, Gambia. So different levels of economic development, different levels of wealth, different levels of educational skills, even within the society, number one. Number two, some of the people from the West are either French-speaking or English-speaking. Nigerians from Nigeria and Ghana come to the United States already speaking English, right? But Senegalese come to the United States not speaking English. So it's that problem. So language is an issue. Number two, some of the countries have enjoyed a certain level of political stability for the last 30 years or four. Some of them are still involved in political and civil wars and internal conflicts in this sense. That's third, from a racial point of view. By the way, the majority of the immigrants, earlier I showed you that, for example, South Africans have the highest level of education, of income, and so forth, right? The majority of South Africans are white, all right? So what we're saying is that Africa is, at least the African immigrants or Africans in Africa too, are of Middle Eastern background, are of Muslim, are white, are black, are French speaking, are English speaking, have experienced different levels of political stability and so forth and so forth. So it is really very, very difficult to speak about Africa as such in this way, right? And this is also, just on a side point, it's already 1 billion people, and this is where the next really economic activities and human growth and economic development is occurring, right, in this sense. But beyond that, I wanted to show you some fascinating stuff about ethnic identities, right? So I looked into the census, and I asked here, remember, starting 2000, we were allowed to select multiple identities, right, in the census. So here, the fascinating that you see is that, see, for example, this is 2000, right? And what you will see is that if you take Kenya, if you take Tanzania, if you take Uganda, but let's take Tanzania, the first, the 42.4% of the people selected Asian Indian as their identity. So who's African now? Is that the question? Which Africa are we talking about? This is really what we're trying to share, right? When you think about Africa, it is really the most diverse continent in the world, and the people that it is sending to the United States are equally diverse as such, in this sense, right? You know. So remember why the British colony took a large number of Indian people wherever it went as endangered servants. So the British colonized in Uganda, the British colonized in Tanzania, the British colonized in Kenya. And so they took millions of people of Indian descent as plantation workers, indentured servants. And when Uganda took its independence, everybody remained. You know, even the British, some of the settled people remained. And so Asian Indians are Asian Ugandans, basically, right? But when you see in Iowa or somewhere, when you'll see someone of Asian background who will say that they're from Kenya. But we don't make the link because we're actually working with the idea that there is a correlation between Africanness and blackness, right? So this is what the idea that we're working with. You know, so this is really to show the multiple identities. And so when you think about this is really especially the case in East Africa, particularly Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. This is sort of racial identities as well. This is at least to show the case of South Africa. And so what you see is that both in the case of South Africa and Zimbabwe, 82% and 40% are white. You know where that idea is coming from, right? You know, the white population of South Africa is the Dutch early colonial settlers who actually, at the end of 300-year process, became Africans themselves. Created an African identity, created sort of a variation of Dutch language, which is called Afrikaner now. And so they're white, but for all practical purposes, they actually became one of the African tribes, the Zulu, the Afrikaner, the Hoxha, like that, in their sense, right? And so they still remain in South Africa. And so remember, and these people actually left Holland, you know, sort of at the turn of the 17th century, And they even took a Christianity that was a little bit older than the one that we're actually using right now. And so if they go back to Holland, they're going to a society that they have no idea who it is. So they are more South Africanist than they are Dutch in these things, right? The other thing that may account is the idea of language, right? The idea of language. There are, as I pointed out earlier, certain Africans who come from certain regions where English is spoken already. And so these have advantages over others. And what you would see is that you will see some situations where 40% of the population are linguistically isolated, right? As linguistic isolation is really a measure of a household measure of the percentage of the population who could speak language either well or very well. In this sense, so there are these multiple things. So overall, really, I'm reacting to the idea of the sort of the unified African identity, which is not actually the case from a point of socioeconomic achievement levels, from, for example, cultural identities, from racial identities, and so forth, right? Yeah. So. I hope that made some sense, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come here.
Can I have a question?
Would you talk about class and elites? I've heard discussion, for example, of Africans who come here, often come from professional families, sending their children here to school. And they don't find much in common necessarily with African Americans, and there's a sort of a tension between African elites and African Americans.
Yes, absolutely. And I think and by the way, there's a very interesting discussion about class within the historical African American population itself, right? A sociologist by the name of Mary Patillo, who is at Northwestern University, wrote two books, at least, that deals with, one of the books is called Black Picket Fences. And so the idea is that there is an increasing number of elite African Americans who are as detached from the urban underclass, black urban underclass, who are as detached from them as anyone else in this sense. Yeah. So I want to start with the comment that there is then a fundamental class dimension within the African American population itself. But the same thing is true among the African immigrant population in terms of its relationship with the African American population. That is, imagine, and thank you very much for the question, because that's a comment that I did not make earlier, which is the overwhelming majority of the African immigrant population who are able to come to the United States are already highly selected. Right, because it is actually very impossible for any ordinary African, aside from the refugees. Now, remember, we said like this, those that come from Somalia, Sudan, Rwanda, because we have an immigration policy that is either skill based or we are part of the United Nations Refugee Convention, which allows people to protect the people who are fleeing from persecution. So those are not, the criteria for those is not skills or education, right? It's because of persecution. But the overwhelming majority of the rest, right, are very, very highly selected. And so they are overwhelmingly educated to begin with. Even the idea of thinking, about the immigration itself and the necessary capital to make that a reality is impossible for any ordinary African individual. And so the people that you see here are relatively upper middle class, well-educated individuals, right? So yes, so they're not aware of each other. The other thing that's happening is that the more educated black immigrant population are not concentrated in any one particular place. There is no spatial geographic segregation, right? Because when you compare that to African Americans, you see definite neighborhoods and areas and regions that you can identify. But the African immigrant population, at least those who are relatively educated, are not concentrated in any particular area. They're all suburbs everywhere and so forth. And John Logan actually points out to that. Yes, please. Yes.
As you talk about the black immigrant population, what do you have any information on what percentage of the people who come from Africa to college, universities in this country, are coming here actually as immigrants and plan to remain here, and how many plan to return to the country? Have you, I'm just not clear about that. And then I wanted to follow up the fact that of those who actually emigrate here and are college educated, either here or elsewhere, your statistics about the percentage of them who are either living in poverty or are quite well-to-do, those are the ones who actually emigrate. Okay, just a clarification on it.
Absolutely. Okay, so it's I haven't sort of because this data comes from the census. So the census data does not look into the visa criteria. But I think there are other organizations that collect the percent of international students that come to the United States along regional and country of origin lines. So even though I don't have the exact number, Nigeria, Kenya, South Africa, Uganda, Tanzania, have the higher number as opposed to Ethiopia or Sudan or Somalia. But that's a very good point. But I want to point out that though, that historically, the majority of the African immigrant population, like many other regions, came as students. It was easier to come as a student, and when they were done, they stayed. A good number actually stays, and they continue to actually stay in the sense. But over the last 20 years, the federal government initiated a number of visa criteria that were designed to encourage immigrants to encourage immigrants that were not significant in the United States. So the idea is that we wanted to encourage more people from all the different regions of the world. Since America is becoming more and more diverse, why don't we, allow this diversity? And so we were running something called the lottery visa. Right. Every year, the federal government runs a lottery, and 50,000 people, people from all over the world register online or do whatever, and we take 50,000 each year. Right. But this was sort of skewed towards Africa and places where we had less of immigrants. And so that and the massive refugee movement is what contributed to the increase in the population. But historically, most of them came as students and then remained after they became. And the same thing was true with even Chinese immigrants and other immigrants, right? Because they already, most of these people already had a bachelor's degree in their country, or at least some degree. And by the time they got a PhD or an advanced degree here, plenty of opportunities in the United States to stay.
I have a related question. And first of all, thank you for a very illuminating talk. Appreciate it. In that Massey study that you cited, the figures added up to 100%, and they were either native or immigrant. And all of these schools have significant foreign students. So were they excluded from this study, or are they included in the immigrant part?
Massey and a number of our colleagues basically, this was a survey. It's actually the National Longitudinal Study of Freshmen, it's called, which goes every year, and it started in 20 years or so ago. And so the survey goes to everybody. But the questionnaire, the survey has a question that says whether one was born outside the United States, or a parent, one of their parents was born outside the United States, and if so, which country or region. So if I don't answer it very well, you know, we can go back again. But so they selected the total number, the entire sample that elected African American ethnic background, and within that they divided into those who were born in a country outside the United States, that's a country in Africa, or one of the parents was born outside the United States. Did that answer the question?
That answers the part for the breakdown. But for the original table, which had the percentages either native or immigrant,
right?
If they ask them, did they have foreign parents? Then were they automatically put in the immigrant group?
Yes,
even if they weren't American at all.
That's a very, very good question. So they were either immigrant first generation, or they were assumed American of foreign parent. That's what they assumed, I think.
Can you talk more about the refugee concentrations from the Sudan and Somalia in Iowa and the Midwest? And is that more of these concentrations in the Midwest than in other parts of the U.S.?
If I take the Somali case, it is so Somalia has provided one of the largest inflow of refugees in the United States today. So it's just roughly 70,000 or so, just the last 20 years, right? So it is the Washington D.C. Metropolitan area. It is the two largest spaces are Columbus, Ohio, and Minneapolis, Minnesota. So it is primarily Minneapolis and Columbus, Ohio, followed by Maine, Iowa, I think Georgia, Atlanta, So I think it's really very interesting. This question is very interesting in multiple ways, because historically, immigrants sort of all the way to, Irish immigrants, Italian immigrants, they concentrated in certain ethnic areas, and not only that, in urban areas, in large metropolitan areas, right? So the large number of Southern Italian immigrants who came at the turn of the 20th century went to certain specific areas. this idea of the Midwest and the rural Midwest is what Audrey Singer, actually, who's an immigration scholar who works for the Brookings Institute, referred to as the new gateway cities. Right, it is this new gateway cities that immigrants figure out now. The social services, everything is not overwhelmed yet. There is some sort of sympathy still. And so immigrants, is, because not even in that sympathy, but immigrants started to figure out that New York is too overwhelmed by immigrants already. And so if you go and start, you know, competing at that level, it's very, very tough. And so they started to realize to move to the Midwest. But what gave the African immigrants, or especially the Somalis, the opportunity was that they totally did not grasp the black-white racial dynamics. So for them, unless they saw it or realized it, it was not part of their thinking. So they went wherever they went without thinking about that. All right. So that is what allowed, for the recent refugees. Once some went and they figured it out that it's okay, then they attracted more in this sense, right? So this is one of the comparison between the historical African American population and the recent, African Americans, African immigrants, is that the majority of these people actually come from a condition in which blackness and whiteness, except South Africa, that blackness and whiteness is not part of the everyday racial stratification language. And so everybody is black, and blackness doesn't really make, it doesn't provide any meaning in that sense. And therefore, only after they learn, after they stay a while, that they learn, but before that, they really have no idea. And so that doesn't stop them from going to rural Iowa, rural Minnesota. It really doesn't matter. So, yes. Yes, please.
Would you talk about where you're going with this in terms of your own research? I can think of a dozen different questions that I don't think you can answer. A comparison between different parts of Africa, why there may be a greater tendency for Nigerians to come here versus Kenyans, for example. Or are there particular tribes in Nigeria that send more people here than other, and all of a sudden that's not available in the census, is it? So how are you going to get to that, the difficult questions?
One, thank you. I thank you very much. I think that's a really, really very, very important question. So, for example, one question that is just beyond this that I'm actually asking right now, and it is part of a paper that is in revise and resubmit with the International Journal of Immigration and Integration, which hopefully will come out very soon, goes, remember, this is basically descriptive data. And so the next level was actually to collect, aggregate data and divide the population into regions. So it is, I'm referring to this as an intra-African immigrant comparison. And so we divide, I have two colleagues who are actually co-authors on this, and so it is North Africa, West Africa, East Africa, and South Africa. We have about 30,000 who, the sample is about 30,000 divided into these four regions, right? So we're divided into these four regions, and we're trying to look at the effect of region of origin on socioeconomic achievement and identity is one thing. What I really, really want to do, in the long run, in the case of Nigeria, we already know from just everyday knowledge that it is certain ethnic groups, right? For example, it's the Igbo, for example, the Hausa have been, are Muslim, and they have, up to now, they have being the sort of the political elite and the economic elite. So they're less likely to immigrate. If they come here, they get their education, they have opportunity to go back. So it is the Igbo that are more likely, and the Yoruba that are more likely to come here. So I don't know. You know, the best way, two things that I'm thinking really, beyond the census, to do a more comprehensive qualitative data on the diversity of the African immigrant population. And not only that, actually compare African Americans and African immigrants in terms of social relations. That is really where I want to go in terms of social relations. There is a very, very tense situation, because the people beyond the skin color really do not operate from the same social values, cultural values, religious values, really. So the point is that it really, skin color is irrelevant in really determining anything when you use the case of the black population, African Americans and African immigrants. Because Africans are coming from a nationality-based identity. So they will tell you that they are Nigerian. You can tell them they're black. Well, I'm black, but, so they're Nigerian, they're Ghanaian, they're so. But the African-American population, just like everyone else in the United States, operates from a skin color identity. And so this is really where I want to see, my research go to in the future. Yes, please.
How do immigrants, as you say, we're coming from a country where the
Immigrants coming from countries that skin color is irrelevant come to this country. How do immigrants deal with that? Where suddenly you're perceived, presumably what you're saying, perceived differently. How do you deal? How does the immigrant deal with that?
It is the most fascinating. It's the most fascinating question. I think this, if people, anyone who can really figure out that discussion would actually fundamentally contribute to sociology, political sociology, psychology, and so forth, and in about the idea of race, racial identities altogether. So far, I started from Canada, Somali immigrants in Canada, and I will actually share some of the articles. I have one article called "Racial Formation is Among Somali Immigrants in North America." They negotiate, they reject, they engage in multiple situations. They ignore. It's a multiple ways of dealing with it. Not necessarily knowing what to do, they just engage in a complicated negotiation process. So sometimes they totally ignore the whole thing, as if though they're not aware of. And also, that is part of the discussion between African Americans and African immigrants, right? The African immigrants are ignoring the real thing and the kind of skin-based discrimination that's occurring, and the other side is making similar comments. So that's why I'm saying I'm really very interested in looking at this relationship in this sense. But so this is what I said. One mayor. A mayor from Owatonna, Minnesota, in 2003 made a comment to the local newspaper when a large number of Somali immigrants came. And so one of his comments was that, whoa, suddenly a large number of people who speak a different language, look differently, are not Christian, and not suddenly just come, into the society. Totally, not blending. It's suddenly a different religion, a different language, a different dress, a different skin color. It's not just black and white now, right? It is multiple other things at the same time, right? So in Minnesota, the idea is that Somalis now are referred to as Somalis. Somaliness and Islam trumps race right away. Because because of other political, global political things, right, about terrorism and other things, that they are part of that. Because remember, all of this, the Black Hawk down, you know, because Somalia was the first place where post Cold War, our military went to really stop the civil war there. And now it is the pirate discussion that they have actually taken the northern coast. Remember, this is a significant percentage of the global trade is crossing there. And they figure it out, well, so what? You know, we're struggling. Why don't we just join, take part of this, you know? So I think the understanding of the multiple experiences of the contemporary African immigrant population will teach us a lot about race relations and racial identities. Yes, please.
To that last question and relating to your answer, and you, there's a book, work of fiction by a Nigerian author, and I just wanted to recommend it to you if you haven't already read it, because a part of it explores that question of how does a person coming from, in this case, Nigeria, where race is not, it's not about anything, tribe may be there, nationality, and how do they relate and how do they deal with all of those conflicts? And you may find some stimulating ideas that you can somehow translate into a sociological variable to look at. But the book is called Americana. Have you read it?
No, but I saw her comment is on NPR or somewhere, yes, just a month or 2 months ago.
And her name is Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. And I think with your research, that's a must read for you, really.
So. Thank you. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Thank you.
Really. Can you tell us about your own ethnic background?
Yes. I was born in Somalia. So I am from Somalia. But I have been, I was just born actually about 100 miles southwest of Mogadishu. Mogadishu is the capital city by the Indian Ocean. A very, very, before the 1990s, this is a region, this is, remember, this is a very old country. Yeah, this is really part of this Mediterranean Red Sea area. And so, and it is, Somalia is a recent name, but it is part of this Ethiopian region, right? It's the Horn of Africa, Ethiopia, Eritrea, Somalia, was just a one region initially that goes back to biblical. And this is maybe one of the areas where also humanity and interaction actually started, by the southern part of the Red Sea region. And so it went through multiple colonies, the Persian, Turkish, all kinds. And so it was a very, very beautiful city. Before the 1990s, with sort of Middle Eastern, Persian, Turkish architecture and all kinds of, later colonized by Italy, actually. One of the two, Libya and Somalia, Italy, the two African colonies, colonial regions that was colonized by Italy was Somalia and Libya. But I came here a long time ago. I came here in 1984, just a year or so after I graduated from high school. I lived in Michigan for 20 some years. All my schooling is from Michigan State and Michigan and Wayne State. So I joined Iowa State just in 2009. But the 25 years prior to that, I was in Michigan. Yeah, initially, just by myself initially. Yeah. But now I have a 21-year-old daughter who's in Grinnell just now, and I have two boys, one that's 14 and one that's 12.
Well, Well, I just wanted to say that your numbers were astounding, and I learned so much from them. But the other reason that I met Dr. Cousseau is that he was coming to talk to us about how we'd done our oral history collection with the labor, because he's interested in launching an oral history project with some of these recent immigrants. So I think by capturing their stories and preserving that part of our history is very essential to our understanding. And I hope that if and when you're seeking, you know, volunteer interviewers or candidates, that you people will volunteer to help you document this. It's very, very important. So if there are no further questions, let's give them another round of applause.
Watching City Channel 4 on TV, online, on demand, on Facebook, and now on the go on your mobile device.